Good morning all. We had seen about transport layer protocols, TCP and UDP and frame formats in the previous recording lecture. Now let us see about transport layer flow control and error control and how they are different from that of data link layer flow and error control. In flow control of TCP, there is no negative acknowledgement. Before that, let us compare why flow control has to be done both in data link layer and in transport layer. In data link layer, the flow control and error control is done across the links, whereas in transport layer, it is done between the end system. If we ensure that every link flow control and error control is done, then why should we again ensure it in the transport layer? It is because the data link layer flow control and error control deals with the issues that rise as because of the media problem, media issues, yes? So because of collision. Yes? So we had various protocols such as selective repeat, go back in, etc. Those flow control algorithms considered that the frame loss or acknowledgement loss could be due to collision and they asked for retransmission. Whereas in transport layer, it is considered that the packet loss is because of congestion. So this takes care of flow control amongst the network when the traffic is high. So in case of transport layer, the assumption is that the loss of packet is because of congestion. So the flow control window, it is directly connected with the network traffic and is dynamically adjusted based upon the network traffic. So that's the reason why we need flow control both in the data link layer and in the transport layer as well. So these slides have been taken from Data Communication and Networks by Firuzon. So here in case of TCP flow control, unlike in selective repeat protocol, we don't have negative acknowledgement. Instead, we send the acknowledgement for next segment expected. We saw that TCP is byte oriented protocol and the sequence number will be the number of the next byte to be received, and acknowledgement will be the next byte expected. So one segment consists of multiple bytes and that segment will be numbered by the number of the first byte in the segment. And so we'll also see in case of selective repeat or go back in, we saw how the window slided. We had various pointers and on what occasion those pointers are moved. Similarly, the moving of the pointers here, we call it as opening window, closing window, shrinking window, which we'll see in the next slide. I said the window size is altered based upon the network traffic. In case of data link layer, we saw that the window size depends upon the sequence number bits. So if you are allocating 3 bits to represent the sequence number, then based upon that the window size is kept. So it is static. Whereas here, it depends upon the traffic. So there is a dynamic relation between the size of sender window and receiver window, which is directly related to the network traffic. So how the receiver window fixes the size of its window and it will advertise that window size to the sender. So that what is flow control? Flow control controlling the traffic between the fast sender and slow receiver. So depending upon the receiver buffer size only, the sender will be able to send the number of packets. So a receiver window will advertise its window size to the sender so that it can send the packets accordingly, so that there is no packet drop because of lack of buffer size. And the next window we are going to see is called as the congestion window, and this window is dynamically increased and decreased based on the network traffic. Basically, what is a congestion? A congestion occurs when the network traffic exceeds the available bandwidth. So when it is nearing the maximum bandwidth, then this window will be reduced. So when there is a packet drop because of congestion, then it is reduced to half the size. And again, after the congestion is alleviated, again this window size will be incremented. Yes. So that is the main features of flow control in TCP. The difference already we have seen. Apart from that, here you can see transport layer is byte oriented rather than frame orientation in data link layer, and here it is the window size is variable than the fixed window size in data link layer. You can see flow control sliding window. So the left side of the window, if it is moved to the right side, it is called as closing. If the right side of the window is moved to the right side, it is called as opening. If the right side of the window is moved to left side, it is called as shrinking of the window. The shrinking of the window is not preferred, because once you have advertised the window size, then it is like revoking the window size. So it is not preferable, though it is possible. So you can see, as in case of the selective repeat protocol and other protocols, here too this is the packets which has been sent and acknowledged, with the packets which has been sent and yet to be acknowledged, the packets that can be sent, etc. So the packets that cannot be sent, because that is the maximum size of the window advertised. So how do you fix this window size? I said it is dynamic. So we saw two windows. One is the receiver window and another is the congestion window. Yes. So the receiver window, it is advertised by the receiver saying that this is my maximum buffer capacity, whereas the congestion window shows that this is the maximum capacity with which you can send, so that there is no loss of packets because of congestion. So when the bandwidth is available, you can send up to the receiver window size. Suppose if the bandwidth is not available, then the maximum number of packets you can send depends upon the size of the congestion window. So how the window size in the sender is fixed is considering the receiver window and congestion window size. Whichever is minimum will be set as the window size of the sender. So for an example, what is the value of the receiver window for the sender A? If the receiver has advertised its buffer size or receiver window size as 5000 bytes and it has got 1000 bytes of received and unprocessed data. So receiver, even though if it is having a certain buffer size, yes, so if it is the buffer size is 5000 bytes, yes, so it cannot advertise the window size as 5000, because already there are 1000 bytes of unprocessed data. Yes, so only the remaining bytes it can advertise to the sender. So what is the remaining number of bytes? So it is 5000 minus 1000, which is equal to 4000. So the receiver will be advertising its window size as 4000, and the sender will consider receiver window size as 4000 bytes. What is the size of the window for the sender if the value of the receiver window is 3000 bytes and the congestion window is 3500 bytes? You can see here the congestion window size is more than the receiver window size, yes, because there is no congestion. Okay, so the bandwidth is available. The sender can send 3500 bytes, whereas the receiver buffer capacity is 3000 bytes. It has only got storage capacity of 3000 bytes. So if the number of bytes exceeds this, then there will be packet drop. So what you do in the sender, considering both this, the minimum of receiver window and congestion window is 3000 bytes, and therefore the host or the sender will set its window size to be 3000 bytes. So this is a certain scenario which has given to understand how the window is formulated. So you can see the congestion window size is given. The receiver has sent an acknowledgement number of 200 with receiver window of 9 bytes. The size of sender window is minimum of the receiver window and the congestion window. So which is 20 and 9. So here you can see it is 9 bytes. The size and bytes 200 to 202, it is already sent but not acknowledged. 203 to 208 can be sent. Bytes 209 and above cannot be sent. Okay? So this is what the window illustration is given. Okay? So given a document like this, you must be able to draw the window. Okay? So 200 to 202 is sent but not acknowledged. So you can see 200 to 202, it is sent but not yet acknowledged. So we have a next pointer here. Yes, so you can see this has been given a different shading. Yes, so you can see the bytes 203 and 208 can be sent. Yes, so and byte 209, though it is available, it can't be sent until the right side of the window opens. When will this right side of the window move right side? Once the advertised window size changes, or once these bytes has acknowledgement has been received, you can open up this window. Yes, so given a document, you must be able to draw the illustration. Given an illustration, you must be able to interpret this illustration and document it. Some points about TCP sliding window. The size of the window is lesser of receiver window and congestion window. The source does not have to send a full window's worth of data. That's why what we saw. The window can be opened or closed, but shrinking is not preferable. The destination can send an acknowledgement at any time as long as it does not result in shrinking the window. The receiver can temporarily shut down the window. The sender, however, can always send a segment of 1 byte after the window is shut down. Yes, so that shutting down of window occurs because there is a heavy traffic issue and you are not able to send any more packets without the loss, then you can shut down the window. But before shutting down, you can send just 1 byte of data and then shut down. Now we'll come to error control. Again, the error control is same as that of the data link layer. The checksum principle is same, acknowledgement principle is same. We do have a timer, but along with the timer we do have another scenario. And yes, so one retransmission timer is sent for all outstanding segments. Let me explain this. The acknowledgement, we know that as in case of data link layer, whenever there is a frame loss, the frame will be resent if the timer expires. Here, in addition to that situation, say the receiver has recovered from severe congestion. Earlier, the buffer size due to some reason was advertised as receiver window size as 1000 bytes, and now the receiver window size has grown from 1000 bytes to 5000 bytes because it has recovered from an error and then it has processed all the data. In that case, the receiver needs to ask the source to send the frame immediately. It need not wait for the timer to expire. So in that case, if the receiver wants the sender to send more frames without waiting until the timer expires, so that triggering is done by the receiver by sending 3 continuous acknowledgements of the next frame. Yes. So if the next 3 frames expected is an acknowledgement frame from the receiver, then immediately what the sender does is, even though the timer has not expired, it will close the timer and then resend the segment starting from the next segment. So this is an additional information. And for retransmission of this, if it is going to send, say like in previous case, it is going to send the window, new window size has been advertised. Eh? So it is sending 5 segments at a time. So it will have a common retransmission timer. This is all just for efficiency reasons. Acknowledgement segment do not consume sequence number and are not acknowledged. We know that every acknowledgement segment will be sent as a separate segment. Yes. So and also the segment is identified by means of the sequence number. Here there is no sequence number for acknowledgement segment alone. For data segment, anyhow you will be having. Here again, data may arrive out of order as in case of selective repeat. If you can recollect, while transmitting, if you have multiple, say this is the receiver buffer. Yes, so you have received the first frame, you have received the third frame. Yes, so in that case, the first and third frame will be stored here. Yes, so the second frame is lost. The same as that of selective repeat protocol. Yes? So this will be buffered and then the acknowledgement will be sent from the receiver side to the sender asking it to resend the second frame. After the second frame is received, both these frames can be sent to the upper layer together for processing. However, the first frame would have been sent earlier itself. But you cannot send the third frame because the second frame has not yet arrived. So, after you receive the second segment, you will send the second and third segment to the layer above for processing. So this is the normal operation. You can see this segment consists of bytes numbered from 1201 to 1400. Yes. So here the server is sending a segment numbered from 4001 to 5000 and acknowledgement. Sending the data along with the acknowledgement is called as piggybacking. Yes, so we have seen what is piggybacking. So piggybacking is just a technique in which you can send the data along with the acknowledgement. Yes, so why this is done? Because you don't want to waste your time. Yes, so not time, it is also bandwidth. Yes, so if you are going to send the acknowledgement packet as the separate packet, then again you should need some header information and again I'm not getting it good. Okay. You need to construct an IP header for that and send it separately. It is going to consume more bandwidth. So how do you save it? You piggyback the acknowledgement along with the data. Now the server data is a segment 4001 to 5000 bytes and the acknowledgement for the byte received from the client. So it has received until byte 1400. So the next byte expected will be the acknowledgement number, which is 1401. Yes. So now this segment is sent, the sender has got no data to send, so just it acknowledges the segment received by server by the next number of the byte received, which is 5001, then 5001 to 6000 is sent, and again same acknowledgement is sent here, and then the few segments are sent together. Yes. So it depends upon the window size. Yes. So it's not stop and wait protocol. So it can send multiple segments as and when it is ready. So here, what happens when the segment is lost? Yes. So here the same thing in this scenario, the segment 701 to 800, it has been sent and it has been lost during transmission. The timer has been started initially. Now a few segments are being sent. Yes, so here you can see before the timer expires, yes, we get an acknowledgement. Yes, so the timer expires. Yes, so the timer will be started. Yes, so meanwhile it again receives acknowledgement 701. Yes, so when the timer expires, it expects an acknowledgement 801 or 901, but the last acknowledgement received is only 701. Yes, so it will resend this segment 701 to 800. Meanwhile, 801 to 900, it is an out of order segment which is stored in this particular location. Yes, so you wait for this. Yes, so if you can compare it with selective repeat protocol, in selective repeat we had used negative acknowledgement if a frame has been lost. Here, if a segment has been lost, still we are using acknowledgement with the number of the next segment received. So that's the difference between the data link layer and the transport layer, error control and flow control.